Welcome to St. Mary's Harefield's Thought for the Day for Wednesday, the 26th of August. We're producing a weekly thought now, a thought for the week on Wednesday, and continuing to journey through the Old Testament book of Proverbs, part of the so-called wisdom literature of the Bible. Our first hymn reminds us of the wonder of God, God's majesty, and God's tender love towards us. My God, how wonderful thou art, thy majesty how bright. How beautiful thy mercy seat in depths of burning light. No earthly father loves like thee, no mother e'er so mild, bears and forbears as thou hast done with me thy sinful child. Yet I may love thee too, O Lord, almighty as thou art, for thou hast stooped to ask of me the love of my poor heart. Let us pray. Lord our God, majestic, wonderful and kind, help us to be conscious of your care for us today. Help us to return our love for you. Amen. We continue our exploration of the book of Proverbs. And today we take a look at a selection of verses from two chapters, looking at four themes which they address. So you might want to read sometime, if you've got a spare moment, Proverbs chapter 10 and 11, two chapters, and you'll get the bigger picture. And we're taking a selection of verses from that bigger picture right now. So Proverbs chapter 10, verse 17. Whoever heeds discipline shows the way to life, but whoever ignores correction leads others astray. And 11, verse 14. For lack of guidance a nation falls, but victory is won through many advisers. Sin is not ended by multiplying words, but the prudent hold their tongues. A gossip betrays a confidence, but a trustworthy person keeps a secret. One person gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. When the storm has swept by, the wicked are gone, but the righteous stand firm forever. So the first two verses that follow a particular theme, 10:17 and 11:14. Whoever heeds discipline shows the way to life, but whoever ignores correction leads others astray. For lack of guidance a nation falls, but victory is won through many advisers. These verses illustrate the benefit of heeding correction in terms of our thinking and behaviour, and of being open to other viewpoints which can helpfully instruct. The problem is we don't like the possibility of being wrong. Other people can often see what we can't see. It's a wise thing to listen to the negative comments of others. They do have a valid viewpoint. Taking heed of what we don't really want to hear can prevent us from stumbling and making mistakes. Proverbs 10:17, whoever heeds discipline shows the way to life, but whoever ignores correction leads others astray. If we refuse to accept correction, we can end up not just going astray ourselves, but leading others astray too. Who is it that we can accept correction from? Do we know a particular person who would be trustworthy in this respect and who we can ask? Also, and fundamentally, considering God, reading the Bible, applying the things of faith, can help us to take the right path and to be the right kind of person. To simply plough our own furrow is not recommended practice. Proverbs 11, verse 14. For lack of guidance, a nation falls, but victory is won through many advisers. It's recommended that those who have the greater responsibility should have a greater number of advisers. This verse particularly addresses the guidance of a nation. A good leader needs wise advisers, and maybe ones with varying opinions. Because any one person's perspective and understanding is bound to be limited. Nobody knows all the facts of every situation. Leaders can be blinded by bias, emotion, or wrong impressions. There are other verses in Proverbs 2 which inform about leadership. We'll leave those for now. We would personally do well to take more advice and to accept wise direction. Proverbs 10:19 and 11:13. Sin is not ended by multiplying words, but the prudent hold their tongues. A gossip betrays a confidence, but a trustworthy person keeps a secret. Do we say too much? Do we tell people what we shouldn't? What we say can have a big effect. James chapter 3, verses 5 to 6 says this, "The tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell." That's a bit strong, isn't it? But it's in the Bible. So it's recommended in Proverbs chapter 10, verse 19, that we say less. Less can be more. Let's not put our foot in our mouth. Let's not say things we might later regret. Things aren't generally improved by making big speeches. Proverbs 11, verse 13, "A gossip betrays a confidence, but a trustworthy person keeps a secret." We probably get to know people we shouldn't say things to, because what we tell them, they will tell others. Those who gossip to you will gossip about you. If people entrust a secret to us, it should remain a secret with us. Are we known to be a person who can keep a secret? We all need someone we can talk to whom we can trust to keep a confidence. By the way, God is in this category. What we say to God in prayer is safely lodged up there. Today we need to be particularly careful about what we say through the social media and internet of our age, because it's out there and can go viral, so to speak. Proverbs 11, verses 24 to 25. "One person gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed." The practice of giving to others and of being generous is highly recommended in many places in the Bible. These two verses present a paradox, that we become richer by being generous. God blesses those who freely give of their possessions, their time, and their energy. The principle is that when we give, God supplies us with more, so we can then give more. This is one aspect of living by faith. Also, giving helps us to gain a right perspective of our possessions. We begin to realize that what we have is not really ours in the first place. What we have is given us by God to be used in various ways and to help others. So if we give, we gain a lot. We become free from being enslaved to what we have. We also have the joy of helping others, and we gain God's approval. Seems to me a pretty good deal. In 2 Corinthians 9, verses 6 to 8, we read this. "Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless you abundantly, So in all things at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. It's wise to live generously. There are many benefits. There will be a great tendency in post-COVID-19 country to be incredibly careful with what we have. But generosity is called for still in this situation, in all situations. In fact, especially now, because some charities, including the church, are going to be in desperate need. So here are some thoughts then. A few verses from Proverbs about accepting correction and taking advice, about watching our words and keeping confidences, about developing a generosity of spirit, because whoever refreshes others will themselves be refreshed. But one more verse leaves us with a thought and a prayer. Proverbs chapter 10 and verse 25. When the storm has swept by, the wicked are gone, but the righteous stand firm forever. Maybe. COVID-19 has caused a bit of a storm. It will have a mixed legacy. It won't sweep away the wickedness of the world, but it can be a time for the righteous, those who want to do the right things, to stand firm, to stand together, and to rebuild. Let's pray that God will enable us to be positive contributors to whatever lies ahead. A hymn that is based on the words of St. Francis of Assisi puts some of these thoughts into a prayerful context, and it goes like this. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord, and where there's doubt, true faith in you. O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there is sadness, ever joy. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving to all men that we receive, and in dying that we are born to eternal life. Let us pray. We pray for resilience in the continuing situation with COVID-19, now that it's 5 months since lockdown. We pray for Oldham, Blackburn and Pendle in their increased restrictions. We pray for those caught up with holidays, travelling and the need to quarantine or not. We pray for all the issues connected to the migrants attempting to cross the Channel. We pray for the people of Belarus continuing to challenge their disputed election. And we pray for serious concerns about the wildfires in California. We also pray for our children and young people affected by the revised A-level grading, GCSE results, and the challenges of opening schools and resuming university education. And we pray for those who are ill, especially those we are concerned about in church. For Astrid, Barbara Leek, Bob Warner, Jean Green, Jarlith O'Connell, Stella Linane, Stuart, and any others known to us. And we pray for those who are bereaved, that God would bring his comfort to the families of Derek Pitt, Graham Farmer, Joyce Bannister, Ken Collingbourne-Smith, Maurice Timms, and any others that we know. The collect for this week. God of glory, the end of our searching, help us to lay aside all that prevents us from seeking your kingdom, and to give all that we have to gain the pearl beyond all price, through our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. In our final hymn, we commit ourselves to trusting God through all the changing scenes of life. Through all the changing scenes of life, in trouble and in joy, the praises of my God shall still my heart and tongue employ. Fear him, ye saints, and you will then have nothing else to fear. Make you his service your delight, your wants shall be his care. Verses from Proverbs. For lack of guidance a nation falls, but victory is won through many advisers. Sin is not ended by multiplying words, but the prudent hold their tongues. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. When the storm has swept by, the wicked are gone, but the righteous stand firm forever. Lord God, help us to accept correction and advice, to hold our tongues and to keep the confidence of others, to live generously that others may be refreshed, and to be involved in rebuilding a little part of your world in whatever lies ahead. So this coming Sunday's church service is again being streamed at 10:30. There are also services now taking place in St Mary's Church at 8 o'clock and 10:30 this Sunday and every Sunday. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this day and always. Amen.